So thanks for the introduction. My name is Battista Biggio. I'm from the University of Cagliari in Italy, and this is joint work with my colleagues from the University of Cagliari, Giorgio Fumer and Fabio Roli, and with Wang Xiao and Claudia Eckert from the University of Munich, and with Gavin Brown from the University of Manchester, UK. So let me just start by sketching the motivation behind our work. And the problem is that in recent years, we have been experiencing an increasing number of services and applications available on the internet. And while on the one hand, this has given us great opportunities, like it revolutionized the way we communicate and interact with people and the way we work. On the other hand, this has also given great opportunities to malicious attackers in the sense that there are many more malicious activities that they can carry on. And so we have experienced also the proliferation and sophistication of attacks and cyber threats carried out by very skilled and economically motivated attackers. And one example is just, for example, how the spam email evolved over time. So this is still a relevant problem after many years. And another one, even more representative, is how malware and computer viruses have evolved and become more sophisticated over time. So for example, you may know that you may just get a computer virus by just opening a PDF file, because you can embed viruses inside PDF files. So as soon as you open the file, just your PDF reader crashes, and now you got infected. And your computer becomes part of a botnet and starts sending spam across the internet. So maybe you don't even notice that. And on the other hand, the good news is that we have also been increasing the sophistication of defense mechanisms. And in fact, several security systems rely on machine learning to detect threats and current attacks over the internet. And this is, of course, a sort of arms race. There is an arms race going on between attackers and defenders. And so it's likely to happen in the near future, and to some extent it's already happening, that we may have attacks targeting the machine learning component of the system. So as an attacker, you may exploit specific vulnerabilities of the learning algorithms to infect the system and compromise system security. So this is for motivating our work, and there's been clearly work on this area. It's called the adversarial machine learning field, but mainly was focused on the security of learning and clustering algorithms. So what we want to investigate here is the security of feature selection procedures, because we think they are really important in security-related tasks like spam and malware detection, for example, because you start from really high-dimensional feature representation of data, and then you need sort of dimensionality reduction to improve the interpretability of decision and the generalization capability of the system. So the question here is using reduced feature sets or compact representation beneficial from the viewpoint of system security, or can it be even counterproductive for that? And to answer this question, we in this work we devised a framework that allows one to think and figure out about potential attacks that may be carried out against feature selection algorithms. And the frameworks consist of different characteristics. So one has to basically model the attacker in terms of the attacker's goal, what he knows or he or she knows about the attacker system, and how she can manipulate the input data. And after you model these three characteristics, you can formalize an optimal attack strategy as an optimization problem. So this is just to give a quick sketch of the framework. In terms of the attacker's goal is defined in terms of the desired security violation. So this is a standard form for security engineering. And you may have different security violations. You may have an integrity violation that usually consists in performing some malicious activities without being caught. So the goal here is to perform some malicious activities without compromising the normal system operation. And in the case of feature selection, so if you're attacking feature selection, this may amount to somehow enforcing the selection of some features that will facilitate evasion of the classifier of the classification system at test time. So for example, if you're a spammer and you want to have some spam misclassified and legitimate at test time, you may somehow influence the feature selection procedure to select features which are easier to manipulate at test time to get your spam misclassified as legitimate. This is an integrity violation. We may have an availability violation, which is exactly the opposite. So here the goal is to cause a denial of service, so to have legitimate user unable to use the system. And so the goal is to compromise the system operation. And in this case, for feature selection, it amounts to enforce the selection of features in order to maximize the error of the system. So you want to create, you want to have cause as many errors as possible during test time. And we may also have privacy violations if one is capable of reverse engineering the feature selection process and somehow infer information, confidential information about the system users. As for the attacker's knowledge, the attackers may have different levels of knowledge about the training data, how features are extracted from the training data, so about the feature representation, and how the feature selection algorithm works, so which procedure are you using to select features and which is the criterion that you are optimizing to select them. And if everything is known to the attacker, we are in the so-called setting, it's called perfect knowledge case. And although this is probably not very realistic, it's interesting to study because it gives us an upper bound on the performance degradation under attack that may be incurred. So it's a sort of worst case analysis. In a more realistic setting, the attacker may know the feature representation and the feature selection algorithm, but only have limited knowledge of the training data. That means it doesn't exactly know the training data used to learn the system, but it can sample data from the same distribution, so it can collect what we call surrogate data, and then learn a system copy using this data. So it can run its attack or its attack strategy over this data and then send these samples, the attack, to the targeted system, to the real one. As for the attacker's capability, since we want to influence the feature selection process, the attacker has to have the capability of injecting or adding points into the training data. And this is the case where you have, for example, online learning systems, which are retrained on data coming during operation. And so it's likely that an attacker can send points during operation, and then they are used to learn the system. There are clearly constraints on the actions that the attacker can do on this data, and of course, usually it can only control a small fraction of the training data, and there are also application-specific constraints that have to be fulfilled when manipulating this data to achieve the attacker's goal. So for example, in the case of PDF data, we can think of a PDF file as a hierarchy of interconnected objects, and while it is easy to add new objects to the file, it's very difficult to remove things from there without compromising the file structure. So if you want the PDF file to keep working, you have to just insert objects. So this is an example of an application-specific constraint. So given these assumptions on the attacker's goal, knowledge, and capability, you can think of different potential attack scenarios against feature selection algorithms, and we sketch a few in the paper, so I'm not going to analyze all of them here, but we're just focusing on the case study we presented also in the paper, which is about what we call poisoning availability attacks. So here the task is, so the attacker can inject samples into the training data, and the goal is to cause an availability violation. That means to enforce the selection of features in order to maximize the generalization error. So the goal is to cause a denial of service. And we test this setting against embedded feature selection algorithms. So usually embedded feature selection works by learning a linear model on the data, either a classification or regression model, and then you can select feature basically by ranking them according to the absolute weight values that are assigned to the features. And usually these algorithms minimize a trade-off between the empirical loss and the regularization term. And if you consider, for example, the squared loss and the L1 regularization, you have the lasso algorithm. If you use the L2 regularizer, you have the ridge regression. And if you consider a convex combination of the two, you have the elastic net. So these are the three algorithms that we studied in this paper. And as for the attacker objective, we consider, so the goal here, remember, is that the goal is to maximize the error, right? So we consider an antagonistic function to that of the learner. And again, it's the same loss and regularizers that we're using to estimate the error. But this time, the attacker optimizes this function with respect to the choice of the attack point. So with respect to the training point that you are adding. And of course, this is going to be optimized. So the loss is estimated using the surrogate data available to the attacker in general. And whereas the function f in the objective of the attacker is essentially the learning algorithm trained on the surrogate data, including the attack point. So there is an inner optimization here which regards the selection of f. So we solve this problem by considering a subgradient ascent technique. So we basically differentiate the attacker's objective with respect to the attack point, and this is how the derivative looks like. The problem is to compute this expression, you need to understand how the solution of the learning algorithm, so the vector W and B and the bias B, change while you're perturbing the attack point into the training set. And to do this, we need to make some assumptions. And in particular, we exploit a trick from the incremental learning field, where basically the idea is to assume that the Karush-Kuntaker conditions remain intact while the point is moving into the training data. And this means that essentially we assume that the solution remains at the optimum. So if we impose that, we have a first advantage, and it is that the subgradient of the regularization term, if you use the L1, is now uniquely determined, and so you can just plug it into the gradient expression. Instead of exploring many possibilities, you just have to focus on one search direction. And what you can do also is to assume that these conditions remain intact, so you can differentiate the KKT with respect to the attack point, and what you get is a simple linear system. And if you solve that, now you know how the weight and the bias change while you move the attack point. So this completes the computation of the gradient, and now we have the gradient, so we can briefly sketch the algorithm. So the idea here is not to consider only one point at a time, but to consider q attack points simultaneously. So this is a loop over the attack point. So iteratively, we consider one attack point at a time. And what we do is basically we update the model incorporating the attack points and compute the gradient, as I showed before. And then we use just a simple line search to find the gradient step size. So here is a simple 2D example where the goal is to separate the blue and the red points. And in the background, in colors, we report the attacker's objective function. And this is computed essentially by adding a red point in each location of the feature space and updating the model. So this is how the function looks like, and if we initialize the attack point here, so like this big red dot in the middle of the blue class, then you can appreciate how the point follows the gradient of the objective function up to a local maximum. And just to show that this is a good approximation of the classification error, we also report the classification error, and you can see that the attack point eventually finds a maximum of the classification error too. So this is just a toy example. Then we carried out some experiments on real data, and in particular we consider the task of PDF malware detection. So as I said, PDFs can be considered a hierarchy of interconnected objects, and in particular these objects are pairs of keyword and data. So this is an example. So several work has proposed to detect the presence of malware or computer viruses inside PDF files by looking at the PDF structure. And in the easiest case, you have just to count the occurrence of keywords inside the PDF. So in this case, for example, we have type occurring twice, we have one page, then we have encoding and so on. So it's just a histogram of features, of keywords. So the learner's task here is to distinguish between benign and malicious PDF files, whereas the attacker's goal is to maximize the error by injecting poisoning points into the training data. And of course, we have to keep into account some application-specific constraints. So given that we can only inject objects into the PDF file, we only feature increments here as the feasible manipulations to the PDF files. As I said, because object removal is complicated, it's not easy to automate. So here are some results. For the perfect knowledge case, we report how the classification error varies with respect to the to an increasing percentage of poisoning samples for the three algorithms mentioned above before. So we have Lasso in red, Ridge in blue, and the elastic net is green. And what you notice is that the more vulnerable one is the Lasso. And this is probably due to the sparsity property of this algorithm. And you reach almost 20% error for 20% injected poisoning samples. We also report the feature subset size, so the size of the selected feature set by each of these algorithms. And as you see, the Ridge typically selects more features because it has a dense solution, of course. So it, on average, it picks 60 features out of the 114 total. So this is a quite interesting result, and we got similar results for the limited knowledge case. So even if the attacker doesn't know the training data exactly, you got more or less the same thing. But a much more interesting result is that if we look at feature stability. So if we consider just choosing the first 30 or 50 features, respectively in the left and the right plot, and we notice something interesting. So we measure stability here with the so-called Kuncheva stability index, which without going into details is a measure that tells you how two feature sets agree. So how many features they have in common on average. And you have positive values if the two feature sets that you're considering agree, so they pick the same features, and negative values if you select completely different features, and you have a zero value if the feature selection is basically random. But this is very important, because what we notice here is that as soon as even if we have a very small fraction of poisoning points, what happens is that the stability of Lasso and the elastic net immediately decreases, almost becoming working as a random feature selector. So, and I think this is a very interesting result, and somehow contradicts the notion of stability that we have common that we know for the L1 regularizer. So, to sum up, we have proposed a framework for the security evaluation of feature selection algorithms, and we have considered a case study involving poisoning availability attacks against embedded feature selection. We've shown that Lasso and sparse feature selection algorithms can be generally more vulnerable than Ridge, for example. And so this raises an interesting research question about the use of L1 regularizers in security-related tasks. And of course, we have some future research directions, including, for instance, some theoretical aspects about the impact of poisoning on learning algorithms and how to devise secure and robust feature selection procedure under attack. So I think this concludes the talk. Thank you.